Congratulations on your prize, because it's the highest prize for IFLA gifts every year, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, being in the library, my understanding, yes, absolutely.
Yes. Could you explain, describe your Oodi library?
Yeah, sure. First of all, thank you for having me and recognizing the Oodi library. Oodi itself, it's a public library in the heart of Helsinki. It has approximately 10,000 square meters, so it's a brand new large building. Mm-hmm. It's built on three floors. Each floor is quite unique in its service and its character and its what it intends to be. So it's not homogenous throughout the building, so it's each floor has a different service and a different vibe that it feels. So on the first floor, for example, it's at street level, so it's kind of an extension of the street, of the urban environment. So there's a large square right next to the city, mm-hmm. next to the city library, and so the whole first floor it's like an indoor street, so it really welcomes the people in to the city. You know, as urban environments have services, shops, and things like that. So this is what you find on the first floor. We have different city services. We have a movie theater, restaurant, and a multi-functional hall there. So there's a lot of things welcoming people right away, and it's noisy and busy. In the second floor, it's the learning by doing, I guess it's an easy way to describe it. So we have our studios, we have computers, we have our urban workshop, we have meeting rooms, gaming rooms, and all sorts of things like that. So that's kind of a very hands-on type activities going on in the second floor. Whereas then the third floor is the actual library itself in the sense of the collections, although we consider the entire building the library, of course. But the third floor is, we call it book heaven, because that's where it's a very inspirational place just by how it's, that architects have designed it and how it looks. There's trees in here and it's almost like an indoor park. And there's lots of room, lots of open spaces and lighting. So it's a very welcoming place for people to come and just spend time.
Mm-hmm. The name of this prize is the most systematic public library of the year award. Could you explain more about what kind of qualities that especially that you impressed the juries?
Well, I think, for example, a lot of the ways we use technology, for example, about the spaces and the services, that these are all that they can be reserved online. And people don't even necessarily have to even interact with the staff to use the facilities. They can, at home or on a mobile device, they can reserve whether the spaces or some of the services that we have, mm-hmm. And they can come in and immediately go to them if they are familiar and know where to go and can navigate themselves in the building. Mm-hmm. That's just one example. But of course, then we have different technologies used in our logistics and our collection management. We have an intelligent management system. So the collections, it's a living collection. It's not a static collection that materials are always brought back to this library. That when people bring return items here, they stay here if we have allocated shelf space for those materials, for example. So we have a very active and ever-changing collection, for example.
Mm-hmm. So it's a technology that you use the most innovative way. Even though you use the technology, but people stay in the library even longer. I think that's very, very good example and advanced thinking. You have a very long long-term project, but could you tell us more about challenges and or and positive experiences you had during this project?
Yes, the development for this and the whole timeline, of course, this is probably at least 10 years of active working and thinking and brainstorming and going through ideas. So it's a very long, has a long history. And this began early with the architecture competition, but there was involvement from the public right from the beginning. So we organized different kinds of workshops with specific users, like library users, but mm-hmm. then there would also be invitations to literary figures, people that are at the cutting edge locally of like urban workshops and these kind of makerspace equipment. We had working groups with families and just many different kinds of things like this. Not just workshops, but there was a lot of active involvement by the library going to events in the city. Mm-hmm. So this way we were able to target specific groups that we wanted to focus on, like families or youth, mm-hmm. and different civic, like city activists that are also active in their own neighborhoods. So we wanted to bring them at the beginning involved and get their ideas that this is not just a building for the librarians, mm-hmm. this is a building for the public. And that was a very strong theme throughout this entire process. So the reason why it took so long is one reason that we wanted them to get their ideas before we even understand what building are we going to build here. There was the idea of a central library for the public, but what shape, what services, how big, what kind of things are in there, we wanted to first get ideas from the public because this is going to be their building. And that kind of gave the definition to the architectural competition. And then after the design was fit there, we still constantly were involved with having people give feedback in consultation with the architects and then starting to refine the interior of the building and how the services will be carried out. And as you can imagine, technology is changing. Mm-hmm. So it's not set in stone from the beginning, but they were a constant, constant process. People were actively involved the entire time.
Mm-hmm. It's very impressive that how you really involved the community to build the library and truly listen to their voices, and that's a really good example. And also after you opened, you already had 3 million visitors in the first year. That you must have a very solid communication strategy throughout, the whole process. And could you tell us more about your strategy and especially communication goals?
When the groundbreaking, for example, construction actually started 2015 on the mm-hmm. site, for example. So the library was. And there was a lot of recognition. We used a lot of social media, a lot of news. There was constant involvement with the city populace. We still went to events, a lot of the festivals, music happenings, city, and kept the visibility of the new library, the Central Library project that it was just commonly termed then. So we were constantly asking people, what do they want? What are the services? When we open up show like we're testing this or trying to get new ideas. So we were quite visible constantly, even as the project, the building was undertaken. It wasn't just that now we have the building, we're going to build it, and then it takes 2-3 years and we open and then come see it. So we were constantly messaging to the public in different connections, different avenues. Whether it's the social media, even in schools, the city has their own channels that they inform the citizens through. So this was a constant showing them where we are. We actually had a live video camera as well that was situated so people can follow the construction literally. But we also kept updating lots of what's happening and what are the services and what ideas that we are coming in what we are refining, for example. So there was a lot of communication throughout and keeping the public updated of what's going on, not just the one way, but continually asking them, do they want to see this in the library? This is new. This is something that's happening and trending here. Would they like to see that in the library? So there's a lot of communication. So people were aware of this. And so when the day came to open, and people were already like very antsy and to get in, and we had line outside for the first two or three days after opening because we exceeded capacity. There were more people outside in line that could actually be in the building because of the fire safety and everything like this. So it was well recognized. And this is, mind you, we opened in December and it's winter, dark and cold. So lots of people were willing to wait outside in the cold to come in and see this place.
that sounds great. How exciting. And could you tell us more about your technology applied in your library? Because your library uses mobile robotics, not only for the collection management, but also interact with the library users. And could you give us some examples of how it works with the users? And do you have any feedbacks from the users?
Well, yeah. Some of the like the physical robotics helping with the logistics, in that sense, they are interacting with the users just by being on the floor, being out in the spaces. It's not just they work in the basement, but they bring the materials, the collections up to the third floor where the collections are. So they are actually moving around and just, so that's a new experience for public to see robots moving around on the floor from the seniors to little kids. They're always getting excited and what is this doing here? So just in this aspect, it's quite good that people are now getting accustomed to seeing robots in public places like this, that they're accustomed to, that they can do jobs and things like that. But some of the ways we specifically use them, we use them in exhibitions. We have done this where we have certain authors, and there's exhibitions related to authors, for example. There might be related to Harry Potter or Faust or things like this. And there have been, the robots then are decorated. They're dressed up as giant spiders or things like this. They move around in the public. So that's just kind of a show part. We have used them as moving feedback places, so they move around and customers can ask what kind of help. There's a selection of choices and people can input what they would like this robot to do for them. And these are pilot testings that we're doing right now, so maybe we can program things. Would they like the robot to show them to navigate the building, to show them where their reserved workroom is, or where a certain item might be located, or where the bathrooms are located, or do they want some more kind of inspirational choices, like give me a book recommendation, maybe on, and if I choose this book and this book that I like, give me a recommendation based on those. So there are some testings that we are doing with that related to these robots specifically.
Wow. And could you tell us more about your various workshops? Because, you know, third floor is an actual library, but you said the second floor offers many workshops and for job development and many other sectors, not only related to the library, traditional library. Could you explain how you connect or build partnership with the different sectors?
Yes. Some of these are workshops or these projects that happen here are independent of us. So we want different, we don't want that we have to be the organizers for everything, because that's, we have other staff, we do other tasks, and we are assisting with the use of equipment and things like that. So we encourage as many groups, associations, schools, universities, things like this, clubs, that they come and can organize certain workshops or projects themselves, independent of our staff, for example, then we have the rooms and the facilities for them to do that. But then we also have workshops where we are do these in either in partnership, or then we act as a facilitator. So we have had for adults as well as children, like coding workshops, small little robotic workshops where we have these small small robots that use some basic, very basic programming, where the children can understand what coding is and how that affects in actual, not just on computers, but in a robotic sense. So we have these coding workshops, for example. Mm-hmm. But then we have different, because of the studios, we can do different kinds of, how would you say, workshops related to just music creation, or then editing, video editing, things like this. We have gaming workshops. Mm-hmm. Some we've had where we invite people, different gamers, and they can together, or then they explain things to the public and explain more about the broader sense of where the gaming creation and technology and how it's becoming its own format in itself. And that it's there's a lot of Finnish companies that do are in gaming and do a lot of gaming code and coding, so these kind of go together. But we also then have workshops related just to the physical aspects, because we have UV cutters, UV printers, laser cutters. We have these hands-on equipment as well. So there's been workshops where knowledgeable people can come and give instructions to maybe their own classes or to their own clubs, associations, so they can use the equipment as well.
Thank you so much. Your library is truly a space for the city, not only for library, but you really expand the space, and also erase the boundary of the traditional library, so you can be a truly space for the public. And also, if the building itself looks very beautiful on the web, so I hope someday when Corona pandemic is over, I can visit your library in Helsinki.
Great to have you
for sharing with us.
Thank you for having me.